life. He who believes in me, though he die, yet shall he live. And whoever lives and believes in me shall never die. The steadfast love of the Lord never ceases. His compassion never fails. Every morning they are renewed. Jesus said, "Let not your hearts be troubled. Believe in God, believe also in me. I am sure that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. If we live, we live to the Lord, and if we die, we die to the Lord. So then, whether we live or whether we die, we are the Lord's. For to this end, Christ died and lived again, that he might be Lord both of the dead and of the living. We brought nothing into the world, and we take nothing out. The Lord gives, and the Lord takes away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. The eternal God is our refuge, and underneath are the everlasting arms.
The body of our sister Edna for burial. Our sister was washed in holy baptism and anointed with the Holy Spirit. Let us therefore with confidence pray to God our Heavenly Father, the giver of life, that he will raise her to perfection in the company of the saints. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. O God of grace and glory, remember before you this day our sister Edna.
We thank you for giving her to us, her family and friends, to know and love as a companion on our earthly pilgrimage. In your boundless compassion, console us who mourn. Give us faith to see in death the gate of eternal life, so that in quiet confidence we may continue our course on earth until, by your call, we are reunited with those who have gone before, through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
The opening hymn 689, 689.
Day of Christ giving, one song let us sing.
Let us pray. Almighty God, we remember before you today your servant Edna, and we pray that having opened to her the gates of larger life, you'll receive her more and more into your joyful service, that if all who have served you in the past, she may share the eternal victory of Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen. Please sit for the first Bible reading.
A reading from the Word of God, written in Wisdom, chapter 3, verses 5 through 9. But the souls of the righteous are in the hand of God, and no torment will ever touch them. In the eyes of the foolish, they seem to have died, and their departure was thought to be a disaster, and their going from us to be their destruction. But they are at peace. For though in the sight of others they were punished, their hope is full of immortality. Having been disciplined a little, they will receive great good, because God tested them and found them worthy of himself. Those who trust in him will understand truth, and the faithful will abide with him in love, because grace and mercy are upon his holy ones, and he watches over his elect. The word of the Lord.
Psalm number 84. Congregation, remain seated.
Oh, Lesson is taken from Revelation chapter 21, verses 2 to 7. I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down of heaven from God, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, "See, the home of God is among mortals. He will dwell with them as their God. They will be his people, and God himself will be with them. He will wipe every tear from their eyes. Death will be no more. Mourning and crying and pain will be no more, for the first things have passed away." And the one who was seated on the throne said, "See, I am making all these things new." All he said, "Write these, for these words are trustworthy and true." Then he said to me, "It is done. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. To the thirsty I will give water as a gift from the spring of water of life. Those who conquer will inherit these things, and I will be their God, and they will be my children." The word of the Lord.
Hymn number 46.
Lord be with you. The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to John, the 10th chapter, beginning at the 11th verse. Jesus said, I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd lays down his life for the sheep. The hired hand, who is not the shepherd and does not own the sheep, sees the wolf coming and leaves the sheep and runs away. And the wolf snatches them and scatters them. The hired hand runs away because a hired hand does not care for the sheep. I am the good shepherd. I know my own, and my own know me, just as the Father knows me, and I know the Father. And I lay down my life for the sheep. I have other sheep that do not belong to this fold. I must bring them also, and they will listen to my voice. So there will be one flock, one shepherd. The Gospel of Christ.
The hymn 174.
One another with these words. May I speak to you in the name of God, who is Father, God, who is Son, God, who is Holy Spirit. Amen. Sit, please. Encourage one another with these words. Words taken from St. Paul's first letter to the church at Thessalonica, chapter 4. And part of verse 18. I'm not aware of anyone who hasn't had the need for some kind of encouragement in their life's journey. I'm not saying that there are none. I'm only saying I'm not aware. That encouragement might have come in different forms. It might have come in the form of a smile, and know that we are able to drop the mask. You can see the smile. For the last 3 years, you couldn't encourage anybody with a smile. Our faces were covered. You could probably have turned them off with a frown, because they saw you for it. It might be a word, a word of encouragement. It might be a hug. Whatever it was appropriate for the time. For to encourage is to offer a sense of assurance. To say to the person, there is hope beyond your present experience. As I reflected on what I would have said this evening for Cheesy, I also reflected on part of my own journey as well. My journey, especially my need for some form of encouragement at that point in time. And it was in Codrington College many years ago. My most difficult time at Codrington College was, the first term in my second year. Why it was that time, I do not know, because you would normally think that the first year might be the most difficult year, but the beginning of my second year was my most difficult. And I found encouragement in one of my fellow students. At Codrington then, I do not know what happens now, there was something called manual. I'm not sure if Mark is in. Yeah, but one of them knows the manual. Is that manual too? All right. Because we had a lot of time to play with in our time at Codrington, and one of the ways of helping to keep us out of mischief was to arrange on Tuesday evenings something called manual. And my manual at that particular point in time was looking after the garden just in front of the chapel. I was in there. And there with a fellow student by the name of Herman Liverpool. Herman Liverpool, an elderly gentleman from Guyana. I do not remember what I said to him. I do not remember what he said to me. All I remember is the exchange we had was helpful, because I didn't have that problem for the remainder of my time at Codrington. I want to say that the encouragement does not necessarily come from what we have to say, or even from what the other person says to us. The encouragement, I think, comes from our courage to face our fears and be prepared to express them. To face our fears and the courage to express them. I want to suggest then that to name our fears is the first step in taking back control of our lives. For we do not enter a new situation to fall into fear. We do not enter a new situation to fall into failure either. And this fear of failure prevents us from acting. Even in the church, we sit next to someone, but we never have a conversation with them. For we walk alongside each other, but we seldom interface with that person. In church, sometimes we do not even know the names of the person who sit next to us. I want to ask you now if you know the name of the person sitting next to you, because you arranged this evening. So you sit next to somebody you know. But sometimes we have that situation, you sit with the person, but I sit there, this is my seat. I'm not necessarily concerned about who's sitting next to me. This is my seat. And as long as I have my seat, it's all right with me. As parish priests of this church for some years, my walk with Edna began, I would say, loosely in 1991 was the year I was appointed as rector of this parish. But my walk with her as an individual never began until sometime much later. It began when I interacted with her in a different way. She's now dead, so I'm not letting out any secrets, but even if there was a secret, I would not tell you at this point either. But it was drawn to my attention that Edna was having some health challenges. And many of us are having our own health challenges. When I came in this evening, one of my old friends, but it may be more appropriate to say one of my friends of old, described to me a health challenge that he is having. My response is, you do not know what old age is if you're never old. So our sister was having a particular health challenge. She was not persuaded that the cure which was being recommended was the cure that she wanted to receive. Like some who are very reliant on their God would believe that all I want is God. I don't want nobody touching me. God will more than take care. God will take care of me. And Edna was one of those persons. One Sunday morning after church, I approached her and had a conversation with her. I don't remember what the conversation was. I don't even remember if she said a word to me. She stood up. She listened. And I learned subsequently that she accepted, or she decided to follow the recommended treatment. From that time onward, my ministry to her was one of personal encouragement. Personal encouragement. Those to whom Paul wrote were having their own moments of anxiety. And I'm sure that, could I be sure? I think so. That all of us in here are having our own moment of anxiety. I don't know what it is. You may not even know yourself. No, you seriously, you may just feel, I feel good. but you are unable to express exactly what is the cause of that not feeling good. We all have our anxieties. We all have our fears. It is interesting that 3 years ago, we said COVID was here and you must wear your mask. How many of you at that time said, I ain't wearing that? A lot. How many of you are saying, oh, I ain't taking off this? See how it goes. You see how it goes? When we were forced to wear it, we protested. Now we have become so comfortable. We all have our anxieties. We deal with them in different ways. And we need that encouragement in order to help us to move on. The people of Paul's day were grappling with the promise of Christ's soon return. For them, they had the expectation that in their own lifetime, they would have seen the second appearing of Christ. But as time went by, they realized that this thing is not working out in the way that we had expected it to be. So, anxiety arose among some of them. But the question, what would happen to those who had died before the Lord put in his second appearance? Paul attempted to assure them, to encourage them with the words. Comfort one another, he says, or encourage one another with these words. What Paul did for them and does for us is that Paul offers a grand picture of what the end time will be. So he said to them and to us, those who have died believing in Christ will rise first. Then we who are living at that time will be gathered up along with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. So Paul was encouraging them and saying to them, those who have died will not be disadvantaged. Those who are alive will neither be disadvantaged. All of us will have an opportunity to meet the Lord, he said in the air, somewhere. A similar promise is made by the same writing of Paul in the Romans 8:38. For I am certain that neither death nor life, nothing on earth will separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. The therefore then follows. Comfort. Encourage each other with these words. I'm not sure that Paul's words sealed the deal for the Thessalonians, for the Romans, or even for us. We are in the season of Advent. And for every season of Advent, we wrestle with the same question. When will Jesus the Christ make his second appearance? And how am I to know? You're asking that question still? Already said there's no point asking that question anymore. When it happened, it happened. Just hope that you are there ready when it happens. So that's basically what we're saying in Advent. It will happen. You do not know when it will happen. But keep watch. The church was intended to be a place and a community that offers hope and encouragement to the world. But we have lost our way. And now we are seen as persons who know only how to condemn and to exclude. For those who were in the Anglican Church in 1959, anybody here living at that time? We had a West Indian liturgy. And a little before we got to the invitation to share in the sacrament at the altar, the priest would say, turn around and say, "Hear what comfortable words our Savior Christ hath all that truly turn to him." Remember those words? You remember them? If you remember them, tell me one of them. I had to go and look them up too, so I got afraid. "Come to me, all you who labor, and I am heavy laden, and I will give you rest." And then John 3:16, "God so loved the world." All right. So the church had good intentions to be a place, a community of encouragers. But as I said, we have lost our way. We condemn now, we separate, and we exclude. Because we think by doing that, some of us will have privilege, the others will not. As I conclude, I ask you to reflect on those moments when you felt you were going through the valley of uncertainty and fear. The other part of the question is, who was there with you? Who was your encourager? This evening there may be many persons here who may think that they have to be encouragers for the family. I would just caution you, be careful what you say. If you don't know exactly what to say, say nothing. Or pull down your mask and smile. Or you may even want to just say, give a gentle pat, a gentle touch. Some time ago, when I was still around, I saw a young lady in the churchyard, and I think she was living overseas, came back. And she entered into a conversation with me and asked me, "Do you remember when my mother died, you touched me on my head and told me it will be all right?" I don't remember that. But for her, that was a moment of encouragement. And it helped her. So I continue to ask the question, where are you now for those who might need your word of encouragement? Your reassuring smile, that gentle touch or hug, and without saying a word, communicate that feeling of assurance, that confidence, that message which says, "I can make it." Sister Cheeseman relied on our presence in the temple of the Lord for her assurance. I was reminded. No, I was not reminded. I didn't know it before. I was told that she was one of the most ecumenical persons around. She visited different churches, different denominations, and her response was, "We are all serving one God." Now that is difficult for many at the Christian level. It is even more difficult for persons at the higher level of different religions. So we have the discussion, if you call it discussion, whether Christians and Muslims and these people can worship together in an ecumenical service for the nation. That's another matter, discussion for another time. She has chosen, or the family chose for her, Psalm 84. And I'll finish with just a few verses to read them from that psalm. "Happy are the people whose strength is in you, whose hearts are set on the pilgrim's way. Those who go through the desolate valley will find it a place of springs, for the early rains have covered it with pools of water. They will climb from height to height, and the God of gods will reveal himself in Zion." And I finish with this word: "Lord God of hosts, hear my prayer. Hearken, O God of Jacob." May I take this opportunity to express condolences, I don't know on whose behalf, but let me be rude and express on the behalf of the clergy present and others. I, Kenneth Wayne, I spoke to him sometime earlier and he asked me to express his own condolence to the family as well. So we want to encourage you. We want to say to you that the experience which you now have is not the last experience that you will have. You will have different experiences. And as you grow, as you move on, may the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace in you. Cheesy? Sleep on. And in St. Vincent they say, "Sleep on, beloved," I can't sing it, "and take your rest. Lay down your head upon your Savior's breast." Sleep on. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Let us now stand and with confidence and hope confess the faith into which we were baptized, as we say the Apostles' Creed as printed on page 7 of the booklet. I believe in God, Father Almighty,
prayers of intercession on page 8 of your booklet. For our sister Edna, let us pray to the Lord Christ, who said, I am resurrection and I am life. Lord, you consoled Martha and Mary in their distress. Draw near to us who mourn for Edna, and dry the tears of those who weep. You wept at the grave of Lazarus, your friend. Comfort us in our sorrow. You raised the dead to life. Raise our sister to eternal life. You promised paradise to the thief who repented. Bring our sister to the joys of heaven. Our sister was washed in baptism and anointed with the Holy Spirit. Give her fellowship with all your saints. She was nourished with your body and blood. Grant her a place at the table in your heavenly kingdom. Comfort us in our sorrows at the death of our sister. Let our faith be our consolation and eternal life our hope. Lord Jesus Christ, we commend to you our sister Edna, who was reborn by water and the Holy Spirit in baptism. Grant that her death may recall to us your victory over death and be an occasion for us to renew our trust in your Father's love. Give us, we pray, the faith to follow where you have led the way and where you live and reign with the Father and the Holy Spirit to the ages of ages. Amen.
The offertory hymn, 695, congregation, during the singing of this hymn, we ask you to make a donation towards the upkeep of this church and cemetery.
as found on page 10 of the booklet. Father, we offer you these gifts which you have given us.
This bread, this wine, and this money. With them we offer ourselves, our lives, and our work. To be we come through your Holy Spirit, a reasonable, holy, and lively sacrifice. As this bread and wine become the body and blood of Christ, so may we and all your people become channels of your love. Through the same Christ, the Lord.
Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right and a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Father Almighty, everlasting God, through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who rose victorious from the dead and comforts us with the blessed hope of life eternal. For to your faithful people, O Lord, life is changed, not ended. And when our mortal body lies in death, there is prepared for us a dwelling place eternal in the heavens. Therefore we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name. Holy, 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 holy Lord.
God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna.
Holy and gracious Father, all creation rightly gives you praise. All life, all holiness comes from you. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, whom you sent to show human nature, to live and die as one of us, to reconcile us to you, the God and Father of all. We therefore bring you these gifts, and we ask you to make them holy by the power of your Spirit, that they may become the body and blood of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, who offered himself in obedience to your will, the perfect sacrifice for all humankind. On the night he was betrayed, he took bread. And when he had given thanks to you, he broke it. He gave it to his disciples and said, take this and eat it. This is my body which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me. And after supper, he took the cup of wine. When he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this whenever you drink it for the remembrance of me. Let us proclaim the mystery of our faith. Christ has died. Father, calling to mind the death your Son endured for our salvation, his glorious resurrection and ascension, his continued intercession for us in heaven, and looking for his coming again in glory, we offer you in thanksgiving this holy and life-giving sacrifice. Look with favor on your church's offering, and grant that we who eat and drink these holy gifts may be filled with your Holy Spirit and become one body in Christ and serve you in unity, constancy, and peace. May he make us a perpetual offering to you and enable us to commune with the Blessed Mary and the whole company of heaven to share in the inheritance of your saints. With him and in him and through him, by the power of the Holy Spirit, we worship you, Father Almighty, with all who stand before you in earth and heaven, in songs of everlasting praise. As our Savior has taught us, so we pray. Our Father in heaven, save us from the time of trial, and deliver us from evil. We break this bread to share in the body of Christ. Lamb of God, take away the sin of the world. Lamb of God, Lamb of God.
The gifts of God for the people of God.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Post-communion prayers printed on page 13 of the booklet. Together let us pray. Almighty God, thank you that great love you have fed us with the spiritual food and drink of the body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ, and have given us a foretaste of your heavenly banquet. Grant that this sacrament may be to us a comfort in affliction and a pledge of our inheritance in that kingdom where there is no death, night, sorrow, but the fullness of joy with all your saints through Jesus Christ.
Good evening, church. I'm just come to do a small appreciation for some persons that were very special to me and helped me through for the last 2 weeks dealing with my mom. At this time, I would really like to thank on the behalf of my brothers and sisters, my sister Wendy. I would say for giving up her life to family, and for being there for mom when everyone else was out working. At this time, I also like to thank my cousin and auntie, who made it very easy for us. When you love someone, and you really love them, and caring for them, and cannot really help at the end, it is difficult. It was a struggle trying to give mom even water and not seeing it so difficult for her to take it in. But a auntie would come over, she would sing, she would clap her hands, because mom was still, she was so happy, but swallowing was really difficult and it was rough. She was there in the morning when I was feeding. When I was bathing, she was there. So, auntie, thank you. Please, Wendy, don't cry. Maureen, I don't know what to say. You are like a hip. When I talk, it was nothing else to do. I will run over. You never say no, but you will come to my aid. You will take her temperature, whatever little you can do. You was there for us. And for all my dear friends that would check in and call, I thank you very much. With the grace and the praise, it helped us to press on. And I really want to say thanks on behalf of the family that we really appreciate you. To my St. John family, thanks, especially the Church Army, the Mother's Union. Every Sunday they were checking to see how she was doing. And it helped us to press on. For all my friends, thanks for coming to helping us through this last couple of days. I will not cry. Shirley, Roberta, Pat, Juliet, thanks for calling and keeping me focused. Thank you once again.
In addition to those who have already expressed condolences, those mentioned by Canon Mears, I add the Reverend Roosevelt Tate and also the Reverend Michael Squires. On behalf of the entire family here at St. John, we'll continue to uplift the family with prayerful support and being there for you. Please stand for the commendation.
To your servant with your saints.
Sorrow be no more. Night is silent, but life is lasting.
You only are immortal, the creator and maker of humankind, and we are mortal, formed of the earth, and to the earth shall we return. For so did you ordain when you created us, saying, you are dust, and to dust you shall return. All of us go down to the dust, yet even at the grave we make our song. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah.
Give rest, O Christ, to your servant, with your saints. We are sorrow and pain are no more. Night is silent.
Lord, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. Our Father, who art in heaven. The power and the glory are yours, now and forever. Let us commend our sister Edna to the mercy of God, our Maker and Redeemer. Deliver your servant Edna, O Sovereign Lord Christ, from all evil, and set her free from every bond, that she may rest with all your saints in the eternal habitations, where with the Father and the Holy Spirit you live and reign, one God, forever and ever. Amen. Into your hands, O merciful Savior, we commend your servant Edna. Acknowledge, we humbly beseech you, a sheep of your own fold, a lamb of your own flock, a sinner of your own redeeming. Receive her into the arms of your mercy, in the blessed rest of everlasting peace, and into the glorious company of the saints in light. Amen.
Amen. Our final hymn in church.
Join in a song, sweet accord, and us around the throne, and us around the throne. We're marching to Zion, beautiful, beautiful Zion. Joys abroad. We're marching to Zion, beautiful, beautiful Zion.
Zion lives above the sacred sea. Almighty God, our sister Edna, and we commit her body to the ground, earth to earth, ashes to ashes, dust to dust. And we beseech your infinite goodness to give us grace to live in your dear love and to die in your favor, that when your well-beloved son shall come again in judgment, both this our sister Edna and we ourselves may be found acceptable in your sight. Grant this for the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
I got it.
Raise us, we humbly pray, from the death of sin to the life of righteousness, that when we depart this life, we may rest in him, and at the resurrection receive that blessing which your well-beloved Son shall then pronounce. Come, you blessed of my Father, receive the kingdom prepared for you from the beginning of the world. Grant this, O merciful Father, through Jesus Christ, our mediator and redeemer. Amen. Grant, O Lord, to all who are bereaved, the spirit of faith and courage, that they may have the strength to meet the days to come with steadfastness and patience, not sorrowing as those without hope, but in thankful remembrance of your great goodness, and in the joyful expectation of eternal life with those they love. And this we ask, in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
angel voices ever singing round thy throne of light. In the sweet by and by.
There's a land that is fairer than day, and by faith we can see. We shall sing on that beautiful shore.
the melodious songs of the blessed, and our spirit shall sorrow no more, not a sigh for the blessing of rest. In the sweet by and by, we shall meet on that beautiful shore. In the sweet by and by, we shall meet on that beautiful shore.
Lord, you have been our refuge from one generation to another. Before the mountains were brought forth, or the land and the earth were born, from age to age, you are God. You turn us back to the dust and say, "Go back, O child of earth." For 1,000 years in your sight are like yesterday when it is past, and like a watch in the night. You sweep us away like a dream. We fade away suddenly like the grass. In the morning it is green and flourishes. In the evening it is dried up and withered. For we consume away in your displeasure. We are afraid because of your wrathful indignation. Our iniquities you have set before you, and our secret sins in the light of your countenance. When you are angry, all our days are gone. We bring our years to an end like a sigh. The span of our life is 70 years, perhaps in strength even 80. Yet the sum of them is but labor and sorrow, for they pass away quickly and we are gone. Who regards the power of your wrath? Who rightly fears your indignation? So teach us to number our days, that we may apply our hearts to wisdom. Return, O Lord, how long will you tarry? Be gracious to your servants. Satisfy us by your loving kindness in the morning. So shall we rejoice and be glad all the days of our life. Make us glad by the measure of the days that you afflicted us, and the years in which we suffered adversity. Show your servants your works and your splendor to their children. May the graciousness of the Lord our God be upon us. Prosper the work of our hands. Prosper our handiwork. God be with you till we meet again.
I love you, Lord, for your mercy never fails me. All my days I've been held in your hand. From the moment that I wake up until I lay my head, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. 'Cause all my life you have been faithful. Of the goodness of God. I love your voice. You have led me through the fire. In darkest night, you are close like no other. I've known you as a father. I've known you as a friend. I have lived in the goodness of God. Hey! 'Cause all my life you have been faithful.
Oh, yes, you have.
And all my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, of the goodness of God. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. With my life laid down, I surrender now. I give you everything, oh Lord. Your
bless her and keep her. The Lord make his face to shine upon her and be gracious unto her. The Lord lift his countenance upon her and give her peace. And now unto him that is able to keep us from falling and to present us faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy. To the only wise God, our Savior, be glory and majesty, dominion and power, both now and forevermore. Amen. May her soul and the souls of all the faithful departed, through the tender mercy of God, rest in peace. Amen.
Let me hear the worshipers! Where's all of my praises? I want everybody around the world to put your hands together because all the praise belongs to God. Here we go. care what you've been through. Just know that praise is bringing you out right now. Nobody can get praise but God tonight. Come on, clap them hands.